Hello everyone, Golden Nova here. Earlier this week, I debuted the first patron-voted video on this channel, but that's not the limit of control I've offered up to all of you. Or should I say, one of you. The highest, most exclusive tier gets to submit a request to me directly, and today's video is the first of what I hope to be many more. This month, our Quasar Commander is Jay Yuri Boy, who has requested I cover the ferocious, fiery, fisticuff fanatics, Battlin' Boxers. For those of you not in the know about Zexal, Battlin' Boxers are the signature deck of Alito, one of the seven Barian Emperors. Before his time as such, Alito was a gladiator that fought using only his bare hands, which informed his deck of choice when it came to applying his might to another sweet science. But while Alito was able to augment his deck with the power of Barian, the average duelist isn't so lucky. So now it's time to see how well these athletes perform in paper. We'll cut a promo for our current roster, coach them through their desired game plan, then see who can make a good sparring partner for them to bring out their best. It's time to get in the ring with Battlin' Boxers. But before we continue, a quick reminder to please like and subscribe if you've enjoyed my content so far. We're bumping up the goal to 10,000 subscribers by the end of the year, but I'm gonna keep what video I want to do for that particular milestone under my hat for just a bit longer. We've also got our Discord, where we're very scared about the new Utopia cards, and if you really like what I do here, please consider joining my YouTube membership or Patreon, which you can find in the description, so you can get your name in the credits, as well as help determine future explain videos that I make. Thank you all so much for watching, and now, back to the video. So, what's the deal with Battlin' Boxers? Well, they're a series of fire attribute warrior type monsters focusing on level 4s for Xyz summoning, though they do have a few other levels strewn about to, I don't know, keep things interesting. And while they all look like they're ready to throw hands at a moment's notice, like many Xyz archetypes, the main deck monsters are there to build momentum until you can get to your extra deck payoffs. Let's start with our level 4s before we cover anything that's a little outside regulation. Battlin' Boxer Glassjaw has 2000 attack and 0 defense, and when they're targeted for an attack, they just get destroyed. Yeah, even a monster with 0 attack can take this down, and they're not even wasting an attack because Glassjaw doesn't have the decency to wait until the damage step to trigger, so your opponent does get to call a replay. It's not all bad though. When Glassjaw is sent to the grave by an effect, including its own, you can target a Battlin' Boxer in your grave, except a copy of itself, and add it to your hand. So while it's not ideal, it is a 2000 attack normal summon that gets you back some resources when your opponent decides to take a swipe at it, so they're more than just your average Joe. Battlin' Boxer Headgeared has 1000 attack and 1800 defense, and once per turn it can be destroyed by battle when it's in face-up attack position. And that's going to be pretty useful for its stat line, because when normal summoned, you can send a Battlin' Boxer from your deck to the grave. There are quite a few boxers that have grave effects that we'll talk about in a bit, but most importantly is that this can send Glassjaw to nab you a card out of your grave. It's a pretty savvy play, and a great example of using your head. Battlin' Boxer Switch Hitter has 1500 attack and 1400 defense, and they're your main Xyz engine. When normal summoned, you can target a Battlin' Boxer in your grave and special summon them, however you can't special summon any monsters except Battlin' Boxers before or after using this effect. It's painful that our best way of getting access to our Xyz is basically keeping us from splashing any other theme, but when they get their eventual legacy support, I'm sure this card is gonna be bonkers. But more annoying than that, I just really don't like the energy that they're bringing to the deck. Like, I love my Switch, it took me a while to get it, I don't want them hitting it. Must be more of a PlayStation fan. Battlin' Boxer Sparrer has 1200 attack and 1400 defense that also helps you gain access to your heavyweights. If you control a Battlin' Boxer monster, you can special summon them from your hand, but if you do, you can't conduct your battle phase for the rest of the turn. Now, this isn't all bad. Cards like Lead Yoke don't specifically thrive in the battle phase, but for the rest of them, yeah, not so much. However, since it doesn't actually lock you out of anything, it can be used with cards that offer removal like Tornado Dragon or Castell. But all of that doesn't take away from its major downside, so make sure you only use it sparringly. Battlin' Boxer Shadow has 1800 attack and 1400 defense, and during your main phase you can detach a material from a Battlin' Boxer Xyz monster you control to special summon them from your hand. It's got a nice stat line, and helps you put the material on board to get even more Xyz monsters, and considering a future entry that can regenerate its materials, it's actually not that bad. Though it is a bit unfair to the rest of the monsters in the theme, because they're all living under this one's shadow. Battlin' Boxer Veil has 0 attack and 1800 defense, and when you take battle damage, you can special summon them from your hand, and if you do, gain life points equal to the damage you took. This isn't super impactful in paper Yu-Gi-Oh!, but it's been a monster in Duel Links, so much so that it had to be put on the Limit 3 list for being such a strong stall card that puts material onto the board that you can use for later. Make a rank 4, throw it into the grave for Purgatrio summons. It's a testament to how unique Duel Links is as a format that a card can find such outstanding meta relevance in it while being completely forgettable in the base game. Sure, it's a thinly veiled compliment, but it's a compliment nonetheless. Let's move down a weight class and talk about our level 3s. Badland Boxer Counterpunch has 0 attack and 1000 defense, and during the damage step on either player's turn when a Badland Boxer you control, well, battles, you can banish Counterpunch from your hand or grave, and your Badland Boxer gains 1000 attack until the end of the turn. Now, this one is pretty tricky. Sure, you can use it like a traditional hand trap and give your opponent a move I like to call the Simo Special when they least expect it, but then it goes right to the banished zone. You could use it as some kind of material, then banish it from the grave to get better value, but then it's completely telegraphed. Either way, it's a good card for helping your monsters get a leg up on your opponents, making it a monster you can counter on. Badland Boxer Rabbit Puncher has 800 attack and 1000 defense, and at the start of the damage step, if they attack a defense position monster, it's destroyed. That's right, we've got our own Drillroid, but other than that, there really isn't much to say about it mechanically. I did find out that a rabbit punch is an illegal strike in professional boxing because it goes for the throat or the base of the skull. Ouch. Feels like this card should have been a lot more powerful if it was based on that. And on a personal note, its mask reminds me of the goblins from Final Fantasy XI, probably one of my top 5 favorite goblin designs in all of goblin media. Badland Boxer Rib Gardener has 100 attack and 1400 defense, and as a quick effect, you can banish them from your hand or grave to target a Badland Boxer you control and banish it until your next standby phase. This is an effect I wish we had more of in the game overall, temporary phaseouts that can be used to dodge interaction. It's just a shame that it's in the theme that either has main deck monsters with little value keeping safe, or exceeds monsters that lose all their material when this effect resolves, and what gets me is that they actually work to make this card worse. In the anime, it can redirect attacks if it's targeted for one when face down, and even detaches all the material from an Xyz monster that triggers that effect. What a riboff! Our last main deck monster is Badland Boxer Big Bandage, and they're also our only level 2, though they won't be that way for long. They have 1100 attack and 1400 defense, and once per turn they can't be destroyed by battle. Also once per turn they can target a Badland Boxer in your grave or that's banished that has a level, and all Badland Boxers you currently control become that monster's level until the end of the turn. A wonderful target for Reinforced Truth, Big Bandage helps to fix some of the mismatching levels to make sure you gain access to the right card at the right time for the right Xyz. It quite literally bandages over some of the deck's sore spots. Pivoting over to our Xyz monsters, it's especially helpful in making the controversial Badland Boxer Cheat Commissioner. It's a rank 3 monster with 0 attack and 1300 defense that takes any 2 level 3 monsters, and while it's on the field, all monsters your opponent controls must attack if able, and while you control another Badland Boxer monster, Cheat Commissioner can't be targeted for attacks. When an attack is declared involving a Badland Boxer monster, you can detach 2 material from them to look at your opponent's hand, then set 1 spell from their hand to your side of the field. Now, you're not likely to get this effect to trigger properly if you let your opponent do as they may, mostly because they'll just pick you off with removal, but also because they can just use or set their spells before this has a chance to activate. But if used proactively, because it doesn't specify how the Badland Boxer has to battle, you have the chance to rip a fairly powerful card out of your opponent's hand when they least expect it, so you can cheat it into play. Okay, now it's time for the real heavy hitters. Badland Boxer Ledyok is a rank 4 monster with 2200 attack and 2000 defense, requiring 2 level 4 Badland Boxers. If any number of your Badland Boxer monsters you control would be destroyed by battle or card effect, you can detach 1 material from Ledyok instead of destroying one of those monsters. Also, when an Xyz material is detached from them, they gain a permanent 800 attack boost. This monster can get really obnoxious really fast. While it's no Dingirsu, it still provides excellent protection for itself and the occasional ally, then swells to enormous heights as it does so, topping off at the extreme 3800. When I talk about cards that can help anchor a field, this is one of the gold standards, as this Ledyok can really help lead the way to victory. Number 79, Badland Boxer Nova Kaiser is a rank 4 monster with 2300 attack and 1600 defense, requiring any 2 level 4 monsters. Once per turn, you can attach a Badland Boxer monster from your hand or grave to them as material, and it gains 100 attack for each material it has. So right off the bat, after a single activation, they're sitting at 2600 attack. Also, when destroyed by battle or your opponent's card effect and sent to the grave, you can target level 4 or lower battle and boxer monsters in your grave up to the number of material Nova Kaiser had while it was on the field and special summon them. Ah, another illustrious card to add to the Nova archetype. While it doesn't have any way to use its Xyz material, the more you stock up, the more powerful it gets, and the more painful it is to get rid of. In fact, if it was still legal, this would have been a wonderful way to get the material needed for heroic champion Rongaminiad. And like I mentioned earlier, this is a great monster to enable Shadow. With the way this monster stacks up material, Nova Kaiser really exceeds expectations. Number 105, Battle and Boxer Star Cestus is a rank 4 monster with 2500 attack and 1600 defense, requiring any 3 level 4 monsters. During either player's battle phase, if a Battle and Boxer monster you control battles an opponent's monster, you can attach a material to negate the effects of the opponent's monster you're battling until the end of the turn, that monster you control can't be destroyed by battle, and your opponent takes any battle damage you would have taken from it. That's right, Star Cestus carries on the legend of Amazonas Swordswoman, letting you apply their outstanding effect to any Battle and Boxer, with the upside of battle destruction immunity with a little bit of effect negation peppered in there for flavor. And it's not once per turn. As long as you have the material and the monsters to throw at a giant dragoon, you can do so. It's a little high-rolly, but hey, it's like I always say, shoot for the Star Cestus, because even if you miss, you'll still land among the denizens of Astral World, who will, upon seeing your Baryon-looking behind, rip you to shreds. This motivational poster thing may need some work. But that's not the end of this muscle-bound melee enthusiast, because like the rest of the Baryon Emperors, Alito's over 100 monsters has a Chaos Xyz form. Number C-105, Battle and Boxer Comet Cestus. It's a rank 5 monster with 2800 attack and 2000 defense, requiring any 4 level 5 monsters, though you're really gonna want to use a rank-up magic to summon it on top of Star Cestus. When this chaotic combatant destroys an opponent's monster by battle and sends it to the grave, you burn your opponent for damage equal to half the destroyed monster's original attack. Also, if they've got Star Cestus as material once per turn, you can detach a material to target one monster your opponent controls, destroy it, and if you do, burn your opponent for damage equal to the destroyed monster's attack while on the field. This means that you've got a really nasty 1-2 punch lined up with your original form. Smack something with Star Cestus that has an effect that keeps it immune to targeting, destruction, or both, then rank up during main phase 2 and blast it away with Comet Cestus for massive damage. It certainly makes for a much more meatier win condition. Alright, time for the spells and traps. Battle and Boxing Spirits is a normal spell that has you sending the top card of your deck to the grave, then targeting a Battle and Boxer in your grave and special summoning it in face-up defense position. This is here to help get your rank 4s into play because it certainly isn't going to help get any of your effects online, that's for sure. Though I guess Nova Kaiser isn't a super bad pick, but don't get excited if you manage to mill a Glassjaw off this card. The mill is cost, not an effect. I know I'm being a bit of a buzzkill here, but I just don't want you to get your spirits up. Jolt Counter is a counter trap that you can activate during the battle phase when a spell or trap card or monster effect is activated while you control a Battle and Boxer monster, and when it resolves, you negate and destroy that card. Yeah, you have a counter trap that can specifically out evenly matched, and more importantly, any monster that has annoying battle triggers, whether when battling or when destroyed. And yeah, this card perfectly encapsulates the interaction between Counterpunch and Glassjaw. It doesn't matter that Counterpunch has zero attack, Glassjaw will fold to anything. I'm telling ya, if this doesn't whip that mean green machine into shape, I don't know what will. Our last card is, appropriately, Last Counter, a counter trap that is hands down the most complicated card in the theme. When an attack is declared involving a Battle and Boxer monster you control and an opponent's monster, you negate the attack, and if you do, send that monster you control to the grave. Then, a Battle and Boxer monster you control, in attack position if you declared the attack, gains attack equal to the original attack of that opponent's monster, also proceed to damage calculation using those two monsters. Then, you take damage equal to the amount of attack gained from this effect. So, that's a lot of words, but how does this work out in layman's terms? Well, you can think of you sending your monster to the grave as part of the cost for activating the card, which forces your opponent to fight another Battle and Boxer you control. The catch is, your monster gets an honest, but only for the original attack of what they're fighting, so hopefully your opponent isn't getting much of an attack boost. This effectively means you'll be getting rid of your opponent's monster, barring any battle destruction immunity, and hit them for that monster's original attack. However, then you take damage equal to the honest boost you got. So, abstracting it down even further, Last Counter is kind of like a counter-trap version of Ring of Destruction with extra steps. But in this case, your opponent takes the damage first, so if both of you are in danger of losing the game from loss of life, they get the short end of the stick on this one. So it's certainly one of the most anime cards in the game, pulling out a win from nowhere by stacking the rules of engagement in your favor. Find a way to win with this, and you'll certainly be leaving a lasting impression. So that's all the battle and boxers, but what do we do with them? Well, that's the tricky part, isn't it? We don't really have a lot of aggro-style effects, no attack boost, multi-attacks, or huge swarming capabilities. Our monsters are more sticky than an offensive powerhouse, but despite being hard to chew on, they don't really have any control effects either, and they lack any kind of tempo control that would make them a strong mid-range strategy. Let's face it, Battle and Boxers are an old Zexal archetype that have received almost zero updates through the Pendulum Era, Link Era, and beyond, and Switch Hitter, one of its best pieces, doesn't play well with other archetypes. But if you saw the type and attribute combinations of this theme and got war flashbacks, then you know that we actually have a bevy of new cards to play with. That's right, Infernoble Knights make their return to the channel, and none too soon, because just about all of their effects deal generically with Fire Warrior monsters. Maugus, Ogier, and Oliver can all give your Xyz monsters a little extra oomph, the Infernoble Arms can search and recycle your cards, Renaud can add you back any counterpunches or rib gardeners that you've banished. There's so much we can take advantage of here. Granted, this does mean disregarding Switch Hitter a lot of the time, and does mean you'll effectively be playing a worse Infernoble deck, but I'm here to tell you how you can make Battle and Boxers better, not Infernobles. If you want to hear me talk about those, I've already got a video for them. Plus Immortal Phoenix Gearfried access, how can you pass that up? Fire Flint Lady can help to mitigate the loss of Switch Hitter. The underlying problem is that Lead Yoke is really, really good, but only accepts Battle and Boxer Xyz material, so you either have to enable them with Switch Hitter or Sparrer. But Fire Flint Lady can act as a Sparrer that, granted, resolves at a -1, but doesn't lock you out of the battle phase or into Battle and Boxers, so you can be much more proactive with them. The targeting protection won't matter for long, but at least it can help keep it safe until you've tucked it under an Xyz monster. We don't have the luxury of spending a lot of material on links, but we do have a few very useful ones. Isolde is a staple of warrior decks at this point, giving you a bit of a delayed search, and if we go deep on the Infernoble Arms, it can also summon out some of our monsters to help extend our combos. We've also got Ferocious Flame Swordsman, which gives us a bit of a boost, as well as replacing itself with another warrior when it burns out. As for a silly tech pick, I think Xyz Import has some very, very funny applications with Lead Yoke. It'll be growing bigger and bigger as it weathers your opponent's blows, and even at one boost, 3,000 is enough to scoop up a lot of monsters, but add one more and very little can escape it. This also means that Lead Yoke can get up to a staggering 4,600 attack, and with the double attack granted by Haute Claire, the Yoke's gonna be on them. And that's all I've got to say about Battle and Boxers. Currently, there isn't much hope that the theme will be anything more than a rank 4 Protect the Castle build that doesn't have the most prime of real estate, but with all the recent love for Utopia, maybe some other Zexal themes will get their chance to shine. Combine that with the support offered by Infernoble Knights, and I wouldn't be surprised if we got a new and improved boxer that can take your opponent out in one punch, man. But now, I'd like to hear what you all have to say. Do you agree that Battle and Boxer is a bit past its prime, or are they the next big underdog story that'll make Little Mac proud? Let me know in the comments, and if you haven't already, please make sure to like, subscribe, and share this video around. It really does a lot to help me out. I'd also like to take this time to thank my lovely patrons, including this month's illustrious Quasar Commander, Jay Yuri Boy. Huge thanks for your support and suggesting this theme, it was very fun to cover, as well as Nebula Navigators, Genesis Yu-Gi-Oh!, Dallas Modest, and the Fresh Prince of Con Air, our Cosmic Crusaders, Chaz Ghost, Colin Todd, Panda PLS, and Legendary Raven, as well as the wonderful Starlight Explorers you see on screen now. If you'd like to join their ranks, please consider becoming a Starlight Explorer by using the join button or supporting me on Patreon for a variety of perks. And if you want to hear me talk about some spicy support for one of my favorite themes, check out this video I did all about the Infernoble Knights. Thank you all so much for watching, and I'll see you next time. Buh-bye.